councillors, we won't make a start. Welcome everybody and thank you for attending this evening's meeting. Before we start, I'd like to acknowledge the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nations as the traditional landowners and historical and contemporary custodians of the land on which the city of Darebin and surrounding municipalities are located. Okay, moving on to the agenda. Item one is membership. The membership is as listed in the agenda, with the exception of Councillor Lena Messina, who is on a leave of absence. Item two, apologies, Councillor Lena Messina. Item three, disclosures of conflicts of interest.
Madam Mayor, I will declare conflict for the item 6.6. I'll explain later.
Thank you. Any other disclosures?
Madam Mayor, just not so much a conflict of interest, but a note, an interest in item 6.2, communications activity. One of the items mentioned is I have legal proceedings commencing on three parties.
Thank you, Councillor Rhodes.
The planning as well.
Okay. I also want to declare a conflict regarding close association for Thackeray Street.
Okay. So that's item. Sorry, it's not listed. Item 15.2. Yep. Any other disclosures? No? We'll move on. Item four, confirmation of the minutes of council meetings. So the minutes of the ordinary meeting of council held on the 3rd of October. Thank you, Councillor Williams. Thank you, Councillor Lawrence. We'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried. Okay, moving on to item five, public question time. So we have a number of questions that have come through online, which I'll go through. Okay, the first question is from John Nugent. Is John in the gallery this evening? Would like to read out his question? No? Okay. Okay, his question was, Madam Mayor, could you please explain why Council upgraded the area next to Preston City Oval with new table seats and park benches when no one uses the area since Councillor Morgan had the unemployed move on? And the response to the question is, as background, the community barbecue area was upgraded as part of Council's citywide beautification works, which were undertaken in the 2015-16 financial year. The area is now used regularly by the community market patrons and visitors to the nearby Preston City Oval. Yep. Okay. So question two is from Nicholas Condoromo. Is Nicholas here with us this evening? No? His question was, me and fellow residents of Lovelace Street have been complaining for a long time about traffic of our supposed residential street, large volume, taking shortcuts and speeding. But Darebin City Traffic Management has given us the runaround and inaccurate manipulated data of traffic on our street. End of day is affecting our lives and Council doesn't want to spend money, but Council has money to spend on other high priority matters, such as improving a park that's nowhere near my home. So as a result, I refuse to pay rates. It's only fair if my council issue is not a priority, then I shouldn't be paying my rates for a park on the other side of the suburb. So council's response is, council allocated $241.5 million in the 2016-17 budget to address traffic management concerns such as those you describe. However, Council manages a road network that consists of over 500 kilometres of road. To ensure that we are using ratepayers' funds in the most appropriate fashion, Council prioritises the treatment of traffic on the basis of greatest need. To determine these priorities, Council has recently surveyed over 300 streets across the municipality, including Lovelace Street. The data collected for Lovelace Street indicated the traffic through the section of Lovelace Street is within acceptable limits with regards to speed and volume. The average daily volume of all traffic was recorded to be approximately 145 vehicles per day in Lovelace Street. Up to 2,000 vehicles per day for local roads is acceptable. Whilst the 85th percentile speed of vehicles was recorded at 47.8 kilometres per hour and an average speed of 41.4 kilometres per hour. It is important to note that roads within Darebin have an average speed of 48 kilometres per hour and carry approximately 1,550 vehicles per day. Considering this, of the 300 roads that were surveyed in recent years, there were 138 roads that recorded higher average speeds and 70 roads that recorded higher traffic volumes than Lovelace Street. These roads are therefore considered to have higher comparative need on a risk and safety basis and are prioritised accordingly for budget considerations and future works. This is not to say that works are not required to Lovelace Street and or other streets, rather Council allocates its limited funding to works of greatest need based on collected data and referencing relevant safety and traffic standards. So question three again is from John Nugent. Could you please advise how the council are doing now that, hang on, let me start again. Could you please advise now that council are doing the parking at the market for a fee? Does this mean all council services can be subcontracted for a fee also? Council has entered into an agreement with the Preston Market Management to provide parking services in accordance with Section 90D of the Road Safety Act 1986, which provides the context for such agreements between private landowners and their respective municipal council. Council does not receive a fee for this service from the Preston Market Management. However, the revenue from the infringement notices is retained by council. Council also has other service agreements similar in nature with Northcote Plaza and Wood Street Medical Centre. Okay, the next question is from Serena O'Malley. Did you want to talk to your... Yep.
Sorry, before I start, I've been asked to raise the issue of the microphone. We're having real difficulty hearing you in the gallery. I wonder if maybe you sit back from the microphone and
mm-hmm.
help.
Yep.
Thanks, Serena.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Yep, okay.
So this question is about the Strathallan Golf Course. The Griswell Nature Conservation Reserve is made up of Griswell Forest, Griswell Hill and Griswell Habitat Link. The Griswell Habitat Link adjoins the 10-hectare Strathallan Golf Course, which creates a wildlife corridor to other creeks and parkland in Darebin. It contains trees that are hundreds of years old, many species of birds, frogs, marsupials, butterflies and native grasses, including the endangered matted flax lily, Dianella ammonia. The golf course is also of historical significance as it forms part of the grounds of the former Arundel Mental Asylum, which treated repatriated war veterans. The area is subject to major and damaging flooding, and further development would exacerbate the flood risk to existing residents at the western end of the course and downstream. And I'm missing something from my overview, which is to say that there is there's a possibility that La Trobe University, which owns the land, will wish to sell the land for development in the near future. So my question is a request, firstly, for a report. Will Council ask its officers to prepare a report, including reference to historical reports generated by Darebin Council, that investigates the terms upon which the land was transferred to La Trobe University, assesses the significance of the site and the risks posed by development? B, could the report please provide recommendations to Council for the ways the planning scheme could be amended to help protect the site and the most appropriate way to lobby the state government to ensure the land becomes a permanent public recreation reserve? Secondly, on a liaison officer, will Council appoint a community liaison / campaigns officer to enhance information exchange between the Council and members of the community who are campaigning to protect the Strathallan Golf Course?
Thank you. So Council can ask for a report to be provided, but in any respect, a report will be provided by management in an appropriate time period. And the second part of that question around appointment of community liaison, we can include that into the report back to Council.
Can I just follow up quickly with when you say an appropriate time period, can you please clarify what that would be, because this is quite an urgent matter?
Yes. Can I ask through the CEO.
Madam Mayor, we have at the moment forward planning. We have up to end of December, so it would be early in the new year, the report, first or second meeting of the new year.
Okay. So there is only one council meeting left for this calendar year, which is next Monday, the 12th. And so the first council meeting back is the first Monday in February that we can receive that report. The next question is from James Sisko. Would you like to read out your question?
Just as a point of clarification before I start, we live on the very last street in Reservoir by Thomas Town. We live on Keon Parade. And we've had crazy noise issues from across the street, and we've been going around in circles since 2011. The business that I originally complained about is now apparently has never been compliant. So with their own zoning, industrial zones, as well as not having a permit to operate as a dairy. So here's my question for you. What does Darabin intend to do about the Whittlesea Business Dairy Pack 1B60 Keon Parade, who for years have been operating outside the legal minimum threshold distance for a dairy manufacturer as stated in provision 52.10 of the industrial planning scheme and trespass across the Darabin border by over 200 meters, affecting Darabin residents' health and safety?
Thank you for your question. Each council is responsible for enforcing its own planning scheme, and matters concerning a business in the city of Whittlesea and issues about amenity impacts from the businesses can only be resolved by the city of Whittlesea. Irrespective of municipal boundaries, residents in residential zones are protected by noise and odour regulations, regardless of the zone the business is in. And I would encourage you to contact the City of Whittlesea in relation to this matter. Sure.
We have responded. We've been in process, like I said, since 2011. And they have stopped responding, actually. So once we pointed out that they were not compliant, they have refused to respond.
Okay. Yes, and as I said, it's, I guess, out of our control. So you will need to follow up again with the city, I'm afraid. And the next question is from Terry Mason. Would you like to read out your question?
The community of Darabin appreciate the endeavours of the council concerning acquisition of the former Ruthven school site and part of the Lakeside school site. We ask for advice on the progress on the sale and transfer of land from the state government to Darabin Council.
Thank you for that question. So council is presently working with the Department of Education and Training to finalise the sale. Our lawyers are reviewing the contract documentation. Once these documents are signed, a deposit will be paid with a settlement in a further 2 to 3 months. And at this stage, it is expected that the titles to both parcels of land will be in council's name by April 2017. Okay. So the next question is from Alan Turner. Is Alan in the audience? Would you like to read your question?
Jim, in regard to the proposed planning changes for 48 Roma Street Reservoir, I'm very much aware that Darabin councillors and Darabin officers are support to keep 48 Roma Street open space for its residents. I'm extremely honoured and satisfied our new councillors want to keep 48 Roma Street as open space, and I'd like to thank them for that. My questions are, what can Darabin Council do to ensure that Government's Land Standing Advisory Committee do not get the opportunity to decide on the rezoning of this open space? And the second one is, I'm aware that a sum of around $1.2 million has been put up for the value of this land at a commercial rate. Has Darabin Council put a figure up to Melbourne Water for the purchase of this site, known as 48 Roma Street, or have Darabin council stuck to their guns and wanting this land gifted.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Madam Mayor, at this point I would like to declare conflict of interest in this matter, because my family has the chief protagonist has done some work for my family. To avoid anything, I'll declare conflict and I'll back it.
Thank you. So thank you for your question. So this matter, as you know, is subject to a report before council this evening. So we are unable to answer this question at this point, but I encourage you to stay around for the discussion and once we get to that agenda item. And the next question is from Lorianne Sharp. Would you like to read out your question?
Thank you. This question is in relation to the complicated parking meters that have been installed 7 weeks ago at the Preston Market site. I did submit a number of questions, but some of them were answered by Ellie Mandridis, the acting manager of parking, this afternoon. One remains, and that is, can council please inform who is actually paying for the inspectors that are monitoring and issuing the infringement notices at the Preston Market site 7 days a week, 8 a.m. to 10 p.m, including public holidays?
So that is actually an operational matter, and I will ask the CEO to respond.
Yeah, the council staff are responsible for enforcing the matter, so all the salary will go from council, but any parking infringement income will come back to the council.
Thank you. Just in relation to that, does that require two inspectors in the evening when it's dark and on public holidays, or?
Madam Mayor, if I can check that and get together with the person questioning,
okay.
I can make a meeting and discuss that shortly.
So the CEO will get in contact and have a discussion with you about that. Okay, thank you, Lauren. That is the end of public question time.
Madam Mayor,
yes.
Can I please mention that with the question about Whittlesea, I'll be putting forward a motion later about that issue.
Thank you.
There's a couple of questions on the floor.
Okay. Yeah, you can take them.
Good evening, Madam Mayor. I've got three questions. Mine are simple ones, housekeeping ones. My first question is, how often are drains cleaned in the area of Narrabin? At times, when it rains heavy, a lot of streets are underwater. Bowling Parade, parts of Albert Street, and several other streets. It goes without question. And a resident approached me who lives in Sanctuary Drive, Bundura. She's lived there for 10 years, and she's never seen anyone cleaning her drains out. They're full of, as she said, baseball bats, not bats, balls and things like that. That's my first question. The second question is, when the developer damages a footpath, the width of the whole block, who checks the footpath that is safe? Or do the residents have to wait 3 or 4 months until such time as the building is finished and they restore the footpath? There's no tapes or signs around it. The destroyer broke the camel's back was tonight. There is $1 million Avenue, a big branch down. There is another one in Argyle Street that's been there for a long
Sorry, can you just clarify what that last question was? What the last question was in relation to? I missed the
tree branches.
Tree branches, thank you.
Could I have an answer in mail, please?
Madam Mayor, Mr. Coffey's questions, all three of them. We do have regular cleaning of the drains, but I don't know exactly how often in that particular location. So we will be able to send the inspector tomorrow if we know the address of the footpath which is being damaged and other areas, and provide you with a written answer shortly. And somebody will call you and make arrangements to inspect those particular positions.
Thank you. If you can tell us the specific address of the drain that you're speaking about, then we can get someone to have a look at it. In relation to the second and third question,
we would contact and arrange those inspections and come back.
Yeah, we'll get in touch about those as well. Was there another question?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. My name is Sophie De Los Santos from Thornbury. My question is, what is Council doing about the upgrade to Penders Park in Thornbury?
Mm-hmm.
Penders Park has been identified as a major neighbourhood park under Council's play strategy. Recently, a number of residents have undertaken a review and an audit of the park and found that it only meets a quarter of the standards under the strategy. As Thornbury is growing and less people have access to backyards and space, this has become a really important piece of parkland for Thornbury as well as the broader Darabin residents. And particularly we do have a lot of residents with special needs and we'd like to see some action in that space.
Yeah.
Mr.
Seary? Madam Mayor, that if the person can give some contact details, we'll contact and provide that information and pass it on to the councillors too. In the recent past, we have had a history of spending some money there, but I cannot really specify what is planned. We'll get back to the president shortly.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy.
Madam Mayor, just to bring to Council's attention, during the section of the agenda which refers to petitions, I'll be tabling a petition of several hundred signatures, which I believe the resident has also signed. As well, and that supports the upgrade to Penders Park as outlined.
Thank you,
so
Councillor.
That'll be dealt with during the petition section of the meeting.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. Another question?
Hi, I actually submitted a question online through the website and it doesn't seem to come through, so you might check out what's going on.
What was your name?
Robin Gallagher.
Do you know what your question was? Do you want to ask it? Yep.
Sorry about it. We'll get that. Verify that.
Provision of car share in Darabin is lacking, with no share cars available north of Bell Street. Given that increasing numbers of people are choosing not to own a car at all, and that car share is very common in other inner-city municipalities, why is Darabin doing so poorly in facilitating the spread of car share through the northern half of the council area?
Mr. CEO?
Yeah, we have had a report on the matter specific to certain areas, some councillors are more aware of the issues than I am, but we have to take that on notice and give the answers back shortly. Yeah.
Thank you.
May I make an addition?
Yes, Councillor.
Madam Mayor. Oh, sorry. It's all right. Yeah. I have a motion which I'll be putting forward at the next meeting relating to electric cars, and in light of this information, I intend to add car shares to that proposal.
Thank you. And you need to stand when you address.
Thanks.
Is there any further questions? No? Okay, we'll move on to Consideration of reports.
Mayor, before we do that, I'd like to propose a reordering of the order of business, and that's because we have a number of community members that have come for specific items and a very full agenda. So if I can read the motion.
Yes.
It's a procedural motion. The council reordered the agenda to be heard as follows. 6.6, Fast Track Government Land Service, rezoning for Park 48 Rona Street Reservoir. 11, petitions. 7.1, future of Preston Market. 8, notices of motion. 9, urgent business. 10, general business. 12, records of assemblies of councillors. 13, reports by mayor and councillors. 14, consideration of reports considered confidential. 15, planning applications. 6, consideration of reports. And 16, the close of the meeting.
Do I have a seconder for that motion? Councillor Williams? I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? It's carried. So we will move on to item 6.6.
Madam Mayor, if I can repeat the key protagonist from the community has undertaken work to our with our family. To avoid any conflict, I do not want to be part of the decision or discussion. Director Hamilton could respond to any questions the council might have this afternoon.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so item 6.6, Fast Track Government Land Service, rezoning for Park 48 Rona Street Reservoir.
Yeah,
Councillor Williams?
I move the motion that point one remains as per report, and point two is amended, if you can have it on the screen. That authorised officers to lodge and present a submission based on the following key points in relation to Park 48 Rona Street Reservoir. The retention of the site for public open space is the priority, and preference for the general residential zone is scheduled 2 as the most appropriate zone to apply to the site if the rezoning will be finalised. And point 3, 4 and 5 as amended to authorise officers to lodge and present a submission with Council's position that 48 Rona Street Reservoir be retained as public open space and that land rezoning be formally reflected as such, write to the Minister for Planning and Managing Director of Melbourne Water requesting that 48 Rona Street Reservoir be retained as public open space and the land rezoning be formally reflected as such. Point four, authorise the CEO, or in this case, the delegated other person, to immediately commence negotiations with relevant parties to retain 48 Rona Street site as public open space if this rezoning is not formalised. This may include land transfers and negotiations of a concessional purchase price which reflects open space use. And point five, Council receive an update as soon as practical and be presented with any negotiable position or options for the consideration prior to finalisation.
Thank you, Councillor Williams. Do I have a seconder for that motion?
I'll second it.
Thank you, Councillor Lawrence. Councillor Williams?
Back in July 2016, it was requested that the site 48 Rona Street be retained with Council for the use of open space. To meet the deficiency in the provision of the neighbourhood play area space that we have, the State Government, we responded to from the water, Melbourne Water, which advises that that the land cannot be sold for less than the value at general Victorian valuation, so therefore it will not be gifted. Now that we're coming up to the point where it's now fast-tracking, the Council has sent letters to the Government and Water, requested the land be formally recognised as current use as public open space, requesting that the land be formally recognised and be gifted, but therefore the response that we received was that it cannot be gifted and that it's now in its final stages. We are at a point where this is a really important part, important piece of open space for residents. It's a safe place to play. It's a place where residents meet and walk their dog. It has many mature trees, such as the red flowering ironbark and spotted gum and the river shiraki, that provide shade, especially during hot nights and days. We have money in our kitty for open space strategies. Therefore, Council can purchase this land 468 squares, and it's similar to the situation that we had with Reuben. Now, I believe that once residents actually can come and go, but open space, once it's gone forever, and we need to try and do as much as we can to try and purchase this land.
Thank you, Councillor Williams. Councillor Lawrence?
Yeah, just briefly, Madam Mayor. This, unfortunately, is a repeating pattern where government agencies are acting like silos and selling off anything that can be commercially exploited. I did meet with residents and go up near to another triangle block nearby, which had been cut into 5 units, and very questionable outcome. Now, the pipe track's been running through our community for over 100 years. It goes to the first reservoir of Melbourne. Our residents have had this land neglected for 100 years in the city, former city of Preston. So this affects both Kazali and Latrobe wards. And we have barren linear parks. Now, Northcote City Council addressed this issue in Thornbury and created neighbourhood environmental links that are habitat links and people's links. It's really important because this triangle gives you a width to both have a play space area, and there's noted that this is actually indigenous trees, both the River She Oaks and the Ironbark are indigenous to this area. They've been planted, I'm not sure by the council or by the community. But really, this is a very important piece of land because it's about saying what quality of open space these pipe tracks should be like. And we can influence that and start that there. And I hope that this is a continuing program that we try and provide shelter and play opportunities along the pipe tracks.
Thank you, Councillor Lawrence. Would any other councillor wish to speak?
I'd like to speak.
Councillor Amir.
I'd like to speak to support Councillor Williams' proposal. This is an area that is really important to the community. It's a space where families play cricket, play football, kids learn to ride their bikes, ride their scooters up and down the edge of the park. It's really important for the community. There's not another space like this in the area. Many people I've spoken to in the last, in the recent weeks about this location and the way that they feel about this space is very strong. It's been there for a very long time, and there's residents who have lived in the area for many decades and have many fond memories, as well as the new families that are moving to the area who are playing in the space and are connecting by walking their dogs, by meeting on a Saturday morning, and so it provides not just an environmental value but also social value to the community.
Thank you. Any other councillors wish to speak? No? Would you like to close the debate? No? I'll put the amended motion as it appears on the screen to the vote. So all those in favour? And that's carried unanimously. Okay, so the next item that we'll move to is item 11, petitions.
Mayor, as I foreshadowed during public question time, I'd like to present a petition to council. I'd ask councillors to bear with me. There is a little bit of text involved in the petition, but I'm required to read that. The petition is to Darwin City Council. We, the undersigned community, wish to advise Darwin City Council that Penders Park needs a substantial upgrade to ensure it meets the requirements for a major neighbourhood park under the council's place-based strategy. Penders Park is so important to the Thornbury, South Preston and broader Darabin community on the east side of High Street, as it is one of few larger parks in the area for people to be able to gather, picnic, walk their dogs, exercise, kids to safely ride their bikes and play. With 4 primary schools and a number of kinders and childcare centres within 1 kilometre, this great space is becoming more critical to all our community as housing densifies and people have less and less private space in their backyards. We ask the Darabin City Council invest in a substantial upgrade to Penders Park, as it is used so regularly by a wide range of community members and groups. This investment would be to upgrade the play area for all abilities, as well as upgrading the amenities council needs to be providing for all members of the community it serves, all abilities and all ages, including the ageing, and the increased younger family demographic, particularly the children in Darabin, who need challenging and interesting nature-based playgrounds. We request council formally consider this petition at a council meeting and to 1, note the significant support for this project by residents, 2, resolve to undertake the master planning process for Penders Park in 2016-17 with the community to upgrade Penders Park as an all-abilities major neighbourhood park, and 3, commit to deliver the master plan for Penders Park under the capital works budget in 2017-18. And then the final point, tell Darwin councillors they need to act now. That's bold and italics. And I should just note, for the purposes of councillors, and I have copies of the front page just to save paper if councillors wish to read it. There are several pages here, 19 pages worth of signatures. It's in the hundreds, I actually lost count. And I understand that there are also some other petitions that haven't been submitted tonight but are also in the community as well. So I'll move a motion to support, to accept this petition at this meeting and to request a report be received at a future council meeting in early 2017 in response to this petition.
Thank you. Do I have a seconder? Councillor Rennie? Yeah. I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried unanimously. Thank you. The next item that we will be considering is item 7.1, which is the future of the Preston market.
I have an alternate motion that I'd like to present.
Thank you.
It has been sent through, and if we can get that up on the screen.
Is that you?
No, that's not one.
Oh. We don't have it?
Well, it was sent in, and
do you have a copy of it to read out now?
I can read it out.
Yep.
Okay, and the alternate motion to reads as follows, is that council notes the broad concerns and responses to the Preston Market storeholders, and 1, authorises the mayor and deputy mayor to call an urgent meeting with Salter Properties Managing Director, Mr. Sam Tarascio, and Mr. Anthony Medich from the Medich Corporation. Also to be invited to the meeting are traders and community representatives from SAVE, our Preston Market Group. The second point in the alternate motion reads as follows, that the council receive an urgent report at the next council meeting on the 12th of December 2016 regarding the establishment of a Preston Market reference group. The report should consider appropriate terms of reference, membership composition, and which may consist of traders and their nominated representatives, members of the Save Our Preston Market Group, representatives from the Preston Market Management, council officers and councillors. Third point is that the council immediately suspends undertaking enforcement of the car parking arrangements associated with the new parking meters in the Preston Market car park and enters into discussions with the Preston Market management to explore alternative parking enforcement arrangements to manage parking restrictions at the Preston Market site. The reason for the suspension are that the operational decision of council to enter into a contract to enforce the new ticketing system on behalf of Preston Market management are A, disadvantaging shoppers, especially cold community members and senior citizens, and may be contrary to council's social inclusion policies. B, adversely affecting council's reputation with shoppers, traders and residents at large. And then point 4 is that the council organises an urgent community meeting within 2 weeks at Preston Town Hall or other suitable venue regarding the future of Preston Market. And the final point, point 5, is that the mayor immediately write to Mr. Richard Wynn, Minister for Planning, requesting that he, A, call in the current planning applications before council regarding Preston Market site, and B, immediately introduce interim planning controls that will safeguard the social significance of Preston Market pending a review of the Preston Market structure plan by council.
Thank you.
Madam Mayor,
sorry,
can you move an amendment?
Yes, just one moment, sorry.
It may help you.
It may help.
I'd like to move an amendment that the contents of notice of motion 8.7 and 8.8 are added to this motion, because I think the motion covers 8.6, which would allow the council to withdraw 8.6, and it's a very comprehensive motion at the moment, but 8.7 and 8.8 have extra things that, that could add to this general motion, because it's the one subject.
Sorry, we're just having a look at those.
I'm happy to do that, so in order to consolidate all the motions together. Yep. So that would include 8.8, yep, Councillor Lawrence?
Yes, 8.7 and 8.8, because your new planning minister section is more comprehensive than the 8.6.
I'm happy to do that.
Okay.
Shall we read those out or just take them as read?
Take them as
read?
Within the
okay.
agenda.
Can we just get clarity? Is it 8.7 and 8.8 to be added?
Yes.
Because 8.6...
Which are notices
covered.
Of motion. Yeah.
Thank you.
So just, I guess, a point of clarification through you, Stephen?
Yes, so through you, Madam Chair. Advice was given to councillors today
Could you please speak up, Jacinta?
Is your mic there?
Just clarify, is Stephen doing
motion? Is it
Mayor or...?
So the Governance Director?
Through you, Madam Chair. Advice was circulated today on those particular points. For various reasons, they were rejected. And in addition, also, in relation to the Governance Local Law, Clause 30, any added words must be relevant to the subject of the motion. So the motion or the officer report is in relation to the redevelopment of the Preston Market. I understand that some of the points that Councillor Greco has added are in relation to parking, which is outside of what the actual report is about.
So if I may, through you, Mayor, the actual report actually refers to the change of parking enforcement to the council, so it's actually part of the report, and the report talks about possible actions to be facilitated by council in relation to the concerns that have been raised by traders, and again, one of the concerns is specifically in relation to the change of parking enforcement that has been instituted or agreed to by the council.
So if the language of the current proposed motions is objectionable, is there some changes that we can make to the motion to make them not?
Through you, Madam Chair, we did look at them and we had legal advice. Unfortunately, there was no amended wording that we could propose for what Councillor Greco is also proposing. But it is, as I said,
just a procedural question, if I can, Mayor. In previous cases where there's been legal advice presented that might be contrary to the wording, the provision has enabled council to reconsider the matter at a subsequent meeting if wording needs to be tightened. I believe, and Councillor Lawrence might correct me, this was the case with Clinty Road, Bundura, the former Smorgies site there, where some wording needs to be corrected at a subsequent meeting. So I just would say, from a historical perspective, council has been able to respond quickly if wording needs to be revised at a subsequent meeting. But on that basis, I'm not sure if there's a seconder. I'm happy to second the motion.
If
there is a seconder,
yep.
I would ask that we allow the mover to speak to his motion.
Yep. Okay. So Councillor Williams seconds the motion. Councillor Greco, would you like to speak to the motion?
Yeah, look, thank you, Mayor. Look, I really don't know where to start in relation to this particular issue. It's been a very controversial issue in relation to the Preston Market. And I think it's fair to say, and I think we need to be honest as a council, is that we've been missing in action in relation to the Preston Market. The Preston Market traders, you talk to any trader,
that they've been concerned for the last few years. Traders have been actually screaming out to us as councillors, as council, and we haven't responded as well as we should have. And I think it's fair to make that critique, and I think we have to state things for what they are, and I'm first and foremost prepared to accept that criticism. The other point that needs to be made is that the community in recent time has also expressed enormous concern about the future of Preston Market. It's a very significant site. I don't have to go through the reasons of why it is significant. We all know about the character and the iconic nature of the market. So what I've moved here today is a very comprehensive approach to actually deal with this problem, to actually put this issue of the Preston Market first and foremost and front and centre so that we can actually deal with it. And to deal with it in a very constructive way, because up until now, it's been a very adversarial arrangement that's been taken place, both with the traders and the developers, the traders with the council, the developers with the council. So here's an attempt to actually try and bring the various parties together. So that's why that in the motion I state that it's divided to various parts. One is actually to get the, to talk to the developers, to talk to the owners, the decision makers, and to get them around in a room together with the council, together with the community, together with the trade, to see if something could be worked out. Why I say that? Because everyone in the community is saying we need to save Preston Market. So if we all say that we need to save Preston Market, let's sit around the table and work out how we're going to save that market. The other points that also go to is about setting up a reference group in order to deal with some of the issues associated with Preston Market. At the moment, it's all done through questions, letters, phone calls, and things. Let's set up a reference group with all the parties involved so that we can actually systematically work through some of the issues. The other points that I raise in the motion relate to putting the issue before the minister, because it's a planning issue. And I think we had met with the minister as community representatives. We have met with the minister, where the minister is actually carefully monitoring the Preston Market. And I feel that it's about time that the minister calls in this application and that the minister takes charge in relation to this particular area, because it's a significant application. It only affects Darwin, it affects the whole northern area. And that the minister actually introduces interim controls to safeguard the social significance of the market. And then there's also and my time's run out, so I'll stop there.
Thank you. Councillor Williams.
This is an iconic site. This is an iconic site. It's been around since 1971. It has a whole and a very important part here in Preston. I believe that being so important that we need to have open transparency. In situations regarding the parking and this parking meter, it's come with no communication to the community. And it's really important and vital because it really discriminates those who have parents and children. You get a ticket, you've got to go back to your car, you've got your children out of the car, and you've got to tell them to stay there, or you've got to race back and forth with you. You've got people who have disabilities. It's a struggle getting back and forth. It also affects the shoppers at the market, it affects the traders emotionally and financially. It's becoming a huge disruption, obviously, to everyone all around. We need to do more in this space, and I think we can, and I welcome Councillor Greco's motion.
Thank you, Councillor Williams. Would any other councillor like to speak? Councillor Lawrence?
Yes, Madam Mayor. I'd just like to not repeat what the councillors previously, Kazali Ward Councillor, Councillor Williams and Councillor Greco, covered, but just cover one issue that was raised. I welcome the amalgamation of the notices of motion with the general motion of the future of the market, because we now have a comprehensive approach to this, which is about community engagement, economic development and planning. Now, I'm just going to talk to the planning a little bit, because for the community to understand. I understand there's been closed door meetings with some people, with ministers and others, but the whole community needs to understand what's going on. The structure plan, which the council has in place, is quite old. Predates, I think, four terms ago. It's quite a long time ago. Structure planning is a slow process, and it's been noted by the state government and the minister that our structure plan and the community doesn't protect the character of the market enough, doesn't protect the social history and the actual current cultural practices and the actual economic activity there. So that's been a criticism from the state government that we actually have to take on the chin and update the structure plan. But that's a very slow process, and we have a live application now, and that has its own timetables. So in terms of the actions that this motion's calling for from the state government, they are one, to call in and deal with this current application, because we have, and it's been pointed out by the state government, a structure plan that does not give us the control to get the outcome the community wants, preservation of the character and integrity of the market. And it's very important, this notice of motion 8.6 we've deleted. People need to understand the updated general motion is stronger because it asks the minister to put in interim controls. So in terms of planning, we need to stop the buck passing between council and state government and settle on some solid principles and interim controls, which we will then try and embed in a structure plan. But that takes longer. So we don't want to go on the merry-go-round. We want to all be on the
same
path.
Sorry, that's time. Thanks,
Thank
Councillor
you.
Lawrence. Any other councillors wish to speak? Councillor Amir?
I'd like to speak. The councillors before me have spoken about this issue already, so I'd like to have a slightly different focus. Part of the, one of the most important roles that councillors play is to represent the community and to address their concerns. And I know that there are hundreds of people in Darebin who call council every day with concerns around everything from rubbish collection to pet registration, and those issues are dealt with very effectively by the staff who do a wonderful job in getting from people having a problem to then that being resolved. And this is an issue where not just one person has called up, but hundreds and hundreds of people have said, we're not okay with what's going on. There's over 1,000 people in the Save Preston Market group who have been very, very active over the last few months, and the community is literally crying out for council to take action. I understand that a lot of action has happened previously, but for me as a councillor, I feel we're getting a very clear message that it isn't enough. And the motion that Councillor Greco has put forward today is addressing that gap between what we've been able to do previously and what we're able to do now.
Thank you, Councillor Amir. Any other speakers? No? So I'll put that to the vote, and just to be clear, what we're voting for is the motion as read out, the alternate motion as read out by Councillor Greco, with the addition of the notice of a motion at 8.7 and 8.8. Yes? Okay. I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? So that's carried unanimously. Okay, we'll move to the notices of a motion now. Notices of motion. So the 8.1, Clean Council, Transparency and Accountability. Councillor McCarthy.
So I'll move that if there's a seconder.
Sorry. Is there a seconder?
Happy to second.
Thank you, Councillor Newton. Councillor McCarthy.
Thank you, Councillor Newton. Thank you, Mayor. This is, I suppose, an important notice of motion from my perspective, and I think hopefully also from the community's perspective in picking up some of the items that have been raised during both the council election process and also obviously in the previous council terms, not just here in Darebin, but actually around Victoria. The starting point with this notice of motion is effectively to generate some work from within council, which will come back to council in February next year. And the work is really around the potential to increase and improve council's transparency when it comes to everything from gifts and donations that councillors may receive, and also the CEO and I suppose the scope there for senior officers as well, particularly at the director level. And that's because we make decisions in this space on a weekly and on a monthly basis, and it's important that people know what connections there exist out there in the community as well. Some of the other reforms relate to governance training and the importance of councillors receiving governance training on an annual basis, but also being able to demonstrate that they understand their roles. There is no qualification that you require other than being elected to serve in this chamber, but if we are to truly elevate the role of governance in this chamber, then we need to start with what are the basics and what are the basic competencies that need to be observed. And that's a critical thing which has been raised time and time again. It was a key issue in the council elections, And I'd like to think that it's an issue that unites this council very strongly in terms of improving standards of governance wherever we can. The final point in the motion, this is 8.1 for the community in the gallery, is to really look at something which, from my own political background and I think for a lot of other councillors here, is really critical, which is the capacity to build consensus wherever we can. And that doesn't mean we don't debate and have points of difference, but for councillors to have that as our mode of action is to, wherever possible, find a consensus on issues, because that's what the community demands and expects from us. The last but not least, and this is the first point, and this is something which I think is undervalued in local government, but I think is really important in terms of getting good outcomes, and that's the value of facilitation skills. We at the City of Darabin actually, I think, do quite well in terms of training our staff to be able to facilitate groups in the community, forums and events, and sometimes we bring in external expertise, but councillors are called upon on a regular basis, in fact a weekly basis, to facilitate community meetings, to facilitate committees and meetings such as this, and it's really important that councillors are employing the best possible practices to be inclusive, to be recognising how to be, I suppose, respectful of difference, and to find an outcome that works for the community. So I'll end it there. They're the reforms.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. Councillor Newton.
I'd like to move an amendment.
Do we do that straight away? Yes, Councillor Lawrence.
Madam Chair, I'd like to move an amendment in relation to item 2 on 8.1, that the gifts to the value of $50 or more be declared so that it aligns with our actual policy, our existing policy.
Do you accept that?
I'm actually happy to accept that.
Amendment?
I'm actually happy to go a step further, because it was just brought to my attention, and speaking with our governance manager and another council today, our gifts and hospitality register actually refers to an amount of $20. I'm happy to. Just to give some context, these are the reforms that I believe were put through in New South Wales. So it was simply to bring us, even though Victoria doesn't require this, to bring us up to the standard, the best accountability standards in local government at the moment. But let's go one step further.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy.
That this will also require a review of the gifts and hospitality.
Through you, Madam Chair, the mover of a motion can't make an amendment. So Councillor Lawrence, are you happy to change your amendment to
Put forward the amendment of $20, because the intent was really to make it align with our current existing disclosure policy, which I believe is the strictest in Victoria.
Thank you. And the seconder accepts that?
Yes.
Would you like to now speak to the motion? Yes.
So just very briefly, I think we have a brand new council here. We've started unified, and I think that this motion, I'm very happy to second Councillor McCarthy's motion, because I think it'll give us a better reputation for Darabin Council and work towards giving the residents a council that they can be proud of.
Thank you, Councillor Newton. Would anyone else like to speak to the motion? No, I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried unanimously. Moving on to item 8.2, Clean Council Public Participation and Democracy. Do I have a seconder for Councillor?
Before there's a seconder, Madam Mayor, you might want to note there is an additional point which has been provided to officers, which hopefully can appear on the screen, which councillors might wish to read before they second it.
Do we have it?
I'm happy to read it out.
Well, they're just going to type it out. Yep. Would you like to read it out, Councillor McCarthy?
I don't have it in front of me, but I remember it pretty well. The additional point would be point 7, and the point would read, provides free training workshops and online resources to assist community members in making submissions to council and other bodies, for example, royal commissions and regulatory reviews.
Thank you. Do I have a seconder for that motion?
I'm happy to second it with a few amendments. I'm not sure whether they've been incorporated or not, but
I don't think they have.
Okay, so I may as well cover off on them. So the amendment will be to, in relation to in relation to 8.21, to include in there a point about reinstating question time. I'll start again. enable questions to be asked without the need to pre-advise council. Yep. Mm-hmm. So that's basically returning back to what we used to do over a year ago.
Questions without notice.
So somebody could come into the chamber, get up on their feet, and just fire a question of us,
yes,
without needing to.
Yep.
We'll get to the debate in a minute.
Councillor McCarthy,
do you accept?
If I could just insert where I think the words might go. Point one would be improve the role of question time by reinstating the capacity to ask questions without notice. And trial the question time model, and then it will go on as it is. So
mm-hmm.
it would simply be reinstating the ability to ask mm-hmm. a question without notice during question time. Happy to accept that.
Thank you.
Yeah, and then the other point, an additional an additional seventh point.
We were up to point eight.
So?
Point eight. So Councillor McCarthy's already added
okay,
to point
an additional
seven.
Ninth point, then it would be that it would read to better facilitate recommendations coming from advisory committees.
Do you accept that
yeah,
amendment?
I do accept that.
Yeah, and the final one is in relation to. I just can't find it at the moment. In relation to allow for comments or submissions prior to hearing specific agenda items?
I think if I'm aware, if I can assist Councillor Greco, that is also to point one,
mm-hmm.
And that is where it says that allows for questions to be asked and answered, and submissions
I would change questions to comments and or verbal submissions.
Happy to accept that.
Yep.
Yes. So can we have all of those written down and passed on to the minute takers, please?
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
Councillor McCarthy, would you like to speak to the motion?
I'll keep it incredibly brief. It's pretty self-explanatory. The key points of this motion, once again, is to receive a report regarding the potential implementation of these changes. These are all about enhancing the capacity of our community to engage, participate and contribute to decisions made by council and its various bodies, including advisory committees, as Councillor Greco has mentioned. Critical to this is the reinstatement of ward meetings or neighbourhood-based meetings, which would be cyclical and would occur and rotate throughout the municipality. So the idea would be that every neighbourhood in the city of Darebin should have an official meeting of council at some stage, either during the year or at least over the course of a couple of years. And that's not a hard thing to do. And there's a capacity in our weekly agenda and our monthly schedules to accommodate that. And it is important for council not to be just here in the chamber, but in fact in the community all the time. The notion of a community planning forum on a monthly or bi-monthly basis is, I know, an issue that's already been discussed by councillors, and provisions being made in our meeting cycle for the first 6 months for that to occur. And that's really the capacity for anyone to come along and make a submission to council and not necessarily have to rely upon a formal submission or a formal meeting such as this. And that's really about opening the doors and enabling more grassroots democracy to occur. The reforms to question time, I think, have been covered adequately by Councillor Greco, and that's really about making sure that this council at every stage is open to questions, criticism and wherever possible submissions, but also to look at the capacity to trial this, which we've never done in Darebin before, which is for people to make submissions to particular items in the agenda. It is done at other councils and it's quite successful. But we would need to adjust quite a few things, but it's not beyond the realm of possibility. The references to social media is really about expanding councillors' capacity to engage with the community on an ongoing basis. Some of us are active in that space voluntarily, but that is a huge expectation from a lot of our community, and that requires dedicated effort. Also the notion of expanding the use of the Hearing of Submissions Committee to enable anyone in the community to make a formal submission that must be considered by council, so that instead of just coming to the chamber here and asking a question, actually generating a submission that generates a council report. And that's really about devolving the democratic process wherever we can. And last but not least, a particular passion of mine and Councillor Greco's from the last term is the use of citizen juries in relation to interrogating anything from our council budget, our capital works programs, our recruitment strategies, you name it. It is something which we, in Darabin, are one of two councils, now three councils, that has undertaken successful citizens' jury processes. I will just point to the exercise that's been undertaken in the city of Geelong, which has been immensely successful, has generated an enormous amount of goodwill, and we can learn a lot from what they've just done as well.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. Councillor Greco?
Just very simply, I'll just say that, look, I've been on council for 8 years now, and I've noticed over these 8 years that the community is putting many more demands on us in terms of having a greater input into our decision making. The community does not just want to elect councillors every 4 years and then they go off and do what they want, and whether you like them or not, then you vote about after 4 years. But the community wants to be involved within the process of those, within those 4 years. And I think that the motion that Councillor McCarthy has put forward enables us to actually explore new ways of community involvement and active participation with their council, and also to deepen, if you like, the democratic processes of our city. So that's why I support this motion. And the final thing that I will say in relation to participatory budgeting and citizens' jury, I note that the Minister for Local Government is also talking about getting councils to do more work around citizens' jury and participatory budgeting, something that the Darabin Council has already done, so we're a step ahead, and I think that having a motion like this will further put those strategies into place.
Thank you. Would any other councillor wish to speak to the motion? Councillor Lawrence.
Yes, Madam Mayor. Look, I fully endorse this motion, and particularly welcome the addition of Councillor Greco in reference to questions without notice. I think everyone knows what that means. That was established in 1996 here, and was somehow councillors were influenced away by external parties to drop that. Anyway, I won't go into that history, but maybe local government bureaucrats are good at being bureaucrats and should let direct democracy run its course. It's very important every citizen has direct access to this council. The first question of 1996 was a lady who had her window smashed by a golf ball at Northcote Golf Course, and she came and asked a direct question of the mayor. And if you can't answer direct questions of the mayor and the chair there, you shouldn't be there. And you can't answer on the stump and know what you're talking about, bad luck. That's part of the excitement of Darabin Council. And we did fix her windscreen. So, and she didn't have English as a first language. So that's very important. Also, this notion of community planning forum that has been incorporated into our schedule of meetings. The councils here and the community need to work at that. I'm not such a great fan of the citizen juries, but that community planning forum can let everyone influence the future agenda of this council. So you're not reacting to business items, you'll actually be generating them. So I think we need to work on that. And that could actually, so restoring our direct democracy access is good, and bringing in that community planning forum.
Thank you, Councillor Lawrence. Are there any further speakers? I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour, raise your hand. That's carried unanimously. Item 8.3, Clean Council Statutory Planning. Do I have a seconder for...
There is an additional point I should add, which hopefully... I apologise to you, I'm going to take us furiously writing that up.
So it's up there on screen. Do I have a seconder for that motion? Thank you, Councillor Rennie. Councillor McCarthy, would you like to speak to the motion?
Yeah.
Can I suggest an amendment?
Sure.
Also? I'd just like to add, in relation to point three, require all permit applications for electronic gaming machines and developments of four stories or more. I'd like to add the words require that all permit applications for electronic gaming machines or in locations that contain electronic gaming machines, and then keep going.
Does the mover accept that amendment?
Yes, I'm very happy to accept that, and I also would note Councillor Greco also submitted a proposed additional set of words, which I'm happy to accept, but it's probably better that it comes from him because I can't add them.
Councillor Greco, did you have an amendment?
Do you want me to say that now? Or?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah, okay. Just again in relation to point three, where it says developments of 4 stories or more, and also 4 dwellings or more on the one site.
Does the mover and seconder accept that amendment?
Happy to accept that. I understand there is a workload concern that's been raised by officers, but this is a report that will come back to us.
Yes, that's right.
That will establish what we need to do to make that happen. So happy to accept that. If the seconder is happy as well.
Councillor Rennie?
I'm not entirely comfortable with that because I'm not convinced that every application for 5 dwellings requires attendance of this council.
Okay, so that means the motion now becomes a standalone motion for Councillor Greco, and I need a seconder for the motion that he's put forward.
I'm happy to, as an amendment, to move the amendment that we also consider 4 dwellings or more on the one site. Again, what's being requested here is just a report, and as was mentioned, when the report comes back to us, if it's determined through the report that...
Before we get into the debate, we need a seconder. Thank you.
The amendment regarding 4 units.
Thank you, Councillor Lawrence. Councillor Greco,
okay.
Would you like to speak to the motion?
I understand the concern that was raised by Councillor Rennie. All I'm suggesting is because it calls for a report and looking at the feasibility of different ways of doing things in regards to the planning committee, what I'm suggesting is that we look at planning applications where it's 4 or more dwellings that have been proposed on the one site, that they come to the planning committee. Look, and what I'm hoping that the report will come back to us with is looking at some historical data to see how many applications that would cover, and if it's something that we can accommodate create a huge workload for the planning committee, it's something that we could do. And I think why it's important that we do this, because I continuously notice, as being a member of the planning committee, is that we're getting more and more applications of greater density within our neighbourhood areas. And I think we need to carefully look at these. And the other thing, that the point to be made, is that the applications that have come to the planning committee that involve 4 or more developments on the one side, and when the planning committee has considered those applications, more often than not, I haven't got the stats here in front of me, but more often than not, the planning committee has rejected those applications. They've gone off to VCAT. Some have been approved by, overturned by VCAT, but also note that many of them in VCAT have also been amended or changed in order to accommodate some of the new reasoning that is actually being put forward. So I think it's incumbent on us as a planning authority that we look at these applications. I think that the community deserves us to look at these applications. And why I say that too, particularly in the Latrobe ward, where there's a lot of people from an English speaking background, they may not be able to put forward objections. And I know that the limit is 5 objections for them to come to the planning committee. But sometimes people from an English speaking background don't put in any objections. And as a result of that, you're getting these 4 or 5 dwelling applications on small blocks being assessed by our officers, when I think it really should be something that we should assess as a planning committee. So I hope that the report explores that, looks at the implications of that in terms of the workload, and then we can make a further decision on whether we're going to adopt that approach at a future meeting.
Thank you, Councillor Greco. Councillor Lawrence?
Yes, Madam Chair, I rise to speak in favour of this amendment, which is to look at this important area of 4 and 5 and 6 units even, being on the one block.
Sorry, just to clarify that you're speaking to the motion and not the amendment?
Has it been accepted? No, I'm speaking in support of Councillor Greco's amendment. So hopefully the report will come back. Now, obviously, in regards to 4 units, on corner sites, 4 units can often easily or reservoir satisfy the planning requirements of both local council and the state. However, with infill development, Four units is often pushing the boundaries, both in Reservoir and in Preston. Now, the issue here is also something the council needs to look at in that report coming back to us about whether there are some criteria where we do win at VCAT, and that is often when there are infill between two other dwellings, and also to do with the neighbourhood character in the area. So there may be some other fine-tuning the officers can report back to us about what criteria we could have on the four-unit call-in to make it effective. Now, the other thing I would mention is when people maximise four units or five on a block, whether it's 670 square metres in Preston or 800 square metres in Reservoir, they're using up a resource and they should be giving a housing dividend to this community. If they're all two-storey, they aren't. They aren't giving access to disabled, they're not giving access to the aged. So that's the other area where we need to put those applications under greater scrutiny.
Thank you, Councillor Lawrence. Is there any further speakers to the amendment? Yeah. So I'll put that to the vote. So just to clarify, what we're voting for is the amendment as it appears in green on the screen to be included in the motion. So all those in favour? And against? That's carried. So back to the substantive motion. Councillor McCarthy, would you like to speak to the motion?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. So the substantive motion is, I think, pretty clear. Importantly, it really proposes, and I hope that councillors are keen to go down this path, because I know it is something our community is very keen to see, which is to reverse the recent decision that removed the recognition of residents outside of 200 metres of a development who currently, under the current rules, aren't recognised for the purposes of the number of objections to trigger a planning committee consideration of a matter. So for some of the developments now in our municipality, 200 metres is very close. For others, it's not that far away. I think it's quite an arbitrary change that was made. And so the proposal is to remove that so that any objection that's lodged is counted, as it has been the case for a long time here at Darabin. The critical point, point two, which I wanted to draw to councillors' attention, is actually something of concern. With more and more medium and high density developments, the model we have here essentially asks for 5 minutes for objectors to be able to speak, and yet we may have objectors speaking in relation to a whole range of different issues. And often the really important issues, which are around overshadowing, the internal amenity of developments, those sorts of things are not heard, and instead other issues are heard. So this is making sure that we can look at the speaking times, should they be proportionate to the size and scale of the development. At the moment, a dual lock development is considered in the same way as a development of 10, 12, 18, or even 28 stories, as we've seen proposed. That doesn't seem to make any sense from my perspective. And I think critically, and I won't talk about the gaming piece because Councillor Rennie managed to cover that with her amendment, but point four I think is really important. It came to me through a proposal from a resident, and I'll circulate that to councillors for their information. There are a lot of people in our city who experience receiving a notification of a planning proposal next door to them or down the street from them. It's the first time they've seen one of these things. They don't know what it means. And at the moment, people who haven't gone through that experience are systemically disadvantaged. So what this is about is potentially through collaboration, for instance, with our neighbourhood houses, with our migrant resource centres, which everybody's are appropriate, to try to provide free training resources to those community members who are engaging in the statutory planning process, often for the first time, who find it incredibly intimidating and often find the experience of dealing even with council difficult because it's their first foray into what can be quite an isolating space. Likewise with VCAT, our officers are terrific when it comes to working with residents
defend
our positions, but it's often the case that residents need to know, they need to ask for that help. So that's what I'm proposing, some free support for our residents to understand the system.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. Councillor Rennie?
Thanks, Mayor. Councillor McCarthy, you've covered many of the things I want to draw people's attention to. I think particularly the ruling about excluding people who live 200 metres away was introduced because of concerns that too much stuff was coming to Planning Committee. I would suggest that much stuff was coming to Planning Committee because residents lacked confidence in the decisions of the planning committee. The answer is not to exclude people. We should be encouraging participation. The answer is to rebuild the confidence that our community has in the planning decisions that are made. With respect to electronic gaming machines, these have significant adverse impacts on our whole community, and those impacts extend to other activities that take place in venues. So if one of these venues were to introduce a children's playground, for example, that would bring kids into the venue, that would increase the harm that might be experienced by the community, and that's the reason why it's very important that we consider all such applications that take place in those venues. So I commend the motion.
Thank you, Councillor Rennie. Are there any other speakers to the motion? If not, I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried unanimously. So item 8.4 is energy and environment. Do I have a seconder for Councillor McCall? I'll second.
I will know that there is a slight change to the motion that should be here on screen.
Okay. I'll just give councillors a moment to read the changes.
So it should be that and then just one and two, so the
so
top section can be the,
do,
in
do you like the first paragraph?
Because the red replaces the
so
black.
Just the red.
Mm-hmm. Just the red. And just for councillors' attention, the two changes are to add point one, and also where it lists who the councillors would be. I've simply said the working group will comprise the mayor and any councillors who wish to, it should be participate or participation. So that it's come as you please.
Thank you. Do I have a seconder for that motion?
I'll second the motion.
Thank you, Councillor Amir. Councillor McCarthy.
Thank you.
Could I suggest a very small amendment?
Yes.
Just in relation to point one, could we add the word state of climate emergency?
That was in the words that were sent through, but it hasn't appeared on screen.
So Council recognise that we're in a state of climate emergency that requires urgent action.
So both the mover and seconder accept the amendment?
That was the original word.
Yes,
so.
But it wasn't on screen, so yes.
Thank you, Councillor Rennie, for that pick-up. I'll just speak to that point very quickly. As many councillors would be aware, and I won't go through the science, things aren't great in climate change. And our community knows that, and in fact our community is very active on this issue and expects us to be taking the actions that we have available to us, which is part of point two. I think a majority of the councillors here actually signed up to that declaration of recognising the climate emergency during the election campaign, and I think it's important that we honour that promise that we made in relation to then following through here in the chamber. Point two is really, what do we do about that? We have recently undertaken and are undertaking a review of our climate change policy. We have two significant and very ambitious targets here at Darebin that were established in 2007 and 2009. One is to reduce our emissions to zero for council's operations by 2020. And the second one, which was formed in a very different context, is to reduce our emissions for the community by 2020. That was before the carbon tax, it was before a whole range of federal policy initiatives, and obviously before Paris and other things. But here in Darebin we can do a lot, and we can learn from our neighbours and places overseas, from cities like Woking, which reduced its emissions at a municipal level, the entire city, community, business and government to zero, and produces 80% of its own energy and sells energy back to the national grid. That's been done. That was done within 10 years. So the Darebin Energy Foundation is a concept that a number of us stood on in the election, and was a well-received concept, really looking at how do we drive that action in a sustained way through the council level, but also at a regional level and contributing to the national effort. That may result in some of the ideas that have been touted, which is a significant expansion of things like the Solar Savers program, extending Solar Savers and that methodology to energy efficiency in the home, looking at the business environment and looking at our most vulnerable residents and the people that rent as well, who are being left behind in these equations. The Darebin Nature Trust is a concept from a different perspective. Our creek committees, our parks and of course our bushland are under constant threat from development proposals, from neglect, and will experience increased pressure with 40,000 more people expected to live in the city of Darabin over the next 14 years. That's the state government's target. We don't have a lot of control over that, but what we do have control over is how we treat our natural environment. It is the legacy we leave for future generations. There is a biodiversity crisis on the planet. We can do what we can here in the city of Darabin with all of our local partners to create that change, positive change around supporting the existing ecology, but also looking at where we can actually increase our ecological
10 seconds.
I'll end it there. I really hope councillors support this, and the work, this is about councillors working throughout Christmas to actually work up these proposals in a lot more detail to come back to.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. I've just been advised by Ms Stevens that it's practiced to name the councillors in the motion rather than it being open to any councillors. So we can change the motion so that all councillors can participate,
yeah.
Or if you would like to opt in and we name councillors.
I'm happy to just say all councillors, comprising all councillors, and if councillors don't wish to attend, then that's their choice. It's not a, it's a working group rather than a decision making forum.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. And you accept that change, Councillor?
I accept the change.
Sorry about that. That should have happened before. You spoke. Councillor Amir, would you like to speak to the motion?
I would like to speak to the motion. It's well recognised that Australia is falling behind the rest of the world when it comes to climate change, but that doesn't mean that Darabin has to follow the federal lead. We can instead be our own leaders, and I'd really like to see Darabin become a leader in climate action. We're well placed to do so, and I would hope that that could not just have really great impacts for people here in Darabin, but a ripple effect across the city and perhaps even further. On Saturday afternoon, I was at a music fundraiser for the Mary Creek, Friends of Mary Creek, who were supporting the Blue Banded Bee, which you may not have heard of, but there was hundreds of people there at the Northcote Social Club on Saturday who were very passionate about the Blue Banded Bee. And that was just one symbol, I think, of the number of people in the area who do care about our natural environment. I come from an ecology background, so I'll name myself as one of them. And I think the proposal by Councillor McCarthy to work together to get some proposals ready over Christmas in time for the council plan, which we'll be working on in the coming months, is excellent timing to be able to achieve this vision that we have for a greener, cleaner Darabin, where we're taking strong action on climate change.
Thank you, Councillor Amir. Would any other councillor wish to speak? No? If not, I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried unanimously. Item 8.5, Council Chamber Sound System, which is put forward by Councillor Greco. Do I have a seconder for the motion?
Happy to second.
Councillor Lawrence, Councillor Greco.
Look, very quickly and very simply, I think that we've received many, many complaints in relation to our sound system, and really simply it just needs to be fixed. And especially for us councillors, some of us have hearing issues, so I think it's important that it gets fixed for that reason, in order to be also consistent with our own policies about social inclusion, and also more particularly for the members of the gallery. Even tonight we heard that certain members of the gallery could not hear particular questions. Our governance officer hasn't got a microphone, for example. And sometimes our governance officer is very difficult to hear our governance officer without a microphone. Councillor McCarthy's got a microphone that belongs to the 19th century there. That needs to be fixed. Actually, it's the microphone that often when it's used by the planning committee objectors, and it often falls into their face. So I think we need to get our act together, move into the 21st century with some good sound systems. Also, the motion talks about and looking at this as a matter of urgency, and also looking at it in relation to our mid-year budget review. So instead of waiting until July or August next year, we have a mid-budget review. Let's look at it there. Also, the motion talks about finding out how we can accommodate the additional expense, if there is an additional expense in improving the sound system, so that we can do something very quickly, get this thing over the way, so we can concentrate on our work.
Thank you, Councillor Greco. Councillor Lawrence?
No, Madam Chair, it's been fully covered.
Yeah, I might just put that to the vote. All those in favour?
That's carried unanimously. Okay, moving on to item 9, urgent business. We have
three.
So those are the ones that we incorporated. Sorry, so 8.6 we have decided to incorporate into 7.1, and 8.7 and 8.8 have been incorporated into 7.1. So urgent business.
Yeah, yep. There's one from Councillor Amir.
Do you want me to read it? Can you put it? Yep, sorry. So, Councillor Amir, we'll give people a moment to read that and call for a seconder.
Happy to second.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. Councillor Amir, do you wish to speak? Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry, this is to accept the motion as an urgent item.
Happy to second that motion. Councillor Amir is moving.
Yes. I would like to move motion.
I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried. Now, would you like to move the motion? Yes.
Yes.
Yep.
I'd like to move the motion.
Yep.
Oh, good to speak.
And I'd like you need a seconder before that. Thank you, Councillor Lawrence. Councillor Amir, would you like to speak to the motion now?
I would like to speak to the motion. This motion comes following a request from the community for the council to take a strong stand against the statements made by the Immigration Minister, Peter Dutton, particularly concerning the Lebanese community in Australia and more broadly Muslim Australians. Darebin is a really multicultural place, and that's one of the things I love about it. It's one of the reasons I chose to live here. I fully condemn the words of Minister Dutton and support the community who feel angered by his words.
Thank you. Councillor Lawrence?
Yes, Madam Mayor. Look, it's as people in this chamber would know, they've just taken an oath of a code of conduct to treat community with respect in our roles at local government. It's really concerning to our community here that has long-standing migration from Lebanon, and where Arabic has been a language we all listen to and hear on the street in this city for a few generations, that a minister of the Crown could embark on such targeting. And I just can't believe, I look at Canada and then I look here and I think, is it 2016 in Canada?
Thank you, Councillor Lawrence. Would any other councillor wish to speak? Councillor McCarthy.
Mayor, I'd just like to point out, and I fully support the motion, but I'd also like to point out to councillors, in case they aren't aware, that Darebin is actually home to a number of Lebanese community associations. One, you can see the office next to Cedars Bakery in High Street, which is one of the major community associations, but there are others dotted around the place, and also Arabic organisations as well. So we have a particular responsibility in this space because of those organisations that have made Darebin home and the population that exists here. And this is actually a very rich tradition, the irony of which is that the city of Darebin started a campaign a few years ago called Racism Stops With Me. It's been picked up by the federal government and by other state governments as a community education campaign. And the irony here is that we have the minister in this role who doesn't seem to have looked at the materials that his own department has endorsed. So I think we need to be really clear. The door is open. The welcome mat is open to Minister Dutton to come and visit. And what a great tour we can give him. And I'm sure our community will be very welcoming.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. Are there any further speakers? I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried unanimously. Are there any other items of urgent business?
Not to my knowledge.
I had an urgent business item.
Oh, yes.
That it related to the COAG meeting.
Yes. Would you like to read out the motion
I sent it through.
Yeah.
Do we have?
If it can appear.
Pop that up. We don't have it to put up on screen. Could you read that out, Councillor?
Don't have it? Okay. I'll see if I can bear with me, if I can locate it.
Okay.
I read it out?
Yes, please.
I sent this through the other day, I believe. Look, the urgent motion that I wish councillors to consider to be placed as an urgent motion agenda item is that the mayor write to the local government representative on COAG, and the who is the ALGA president, Mayor David O'Loughlin, to advocate for the inclusion of a family violence leave clause in the national employment standards at the COAG meeting to be held on the 9th of December 2016.
Happy to second if it's not seconded.
Thank you, Councillor Lawrence. I'll put that to the vote to include this as an item of urgent business. All those in favour? It's carried unanimously. Councillor Greco would. Do I have a seconder for the motion?
Standard motion.
Thank you, Councillor Lawrence.
I think the motion is pretty self-explanatory. What it is that on this Friday, I believe, there's a meeting of COAG. COAG, as we know, is the meeting between the Prime Minister and the premiers of the various states. And also at that meeting participates the ALGA, which is the Australian Local Government Authority representative, who represents all the councils across Australia. And what's being discussed on that agenda at that meeting is the inclusion of the family violence leave as a clause in the national employment standards. I think it's very, very important that our representative, our local government representative, make strong representations at that COAG meeting to get those standards into the national employment framework. This request has come to us. I'm sure all councils would have received a letter from the ASU, where the ASU has been battling a lot in relation to this particular issue. And it's actually the ASU that's calling upon us to make some representations to David O'Loughlin, who's going to be representing local governments in that forum. And the reason why David Council needs to act on this is that we are one of the councils very much at the forefront in relation to tackling the issue of family violence. I understand as part of our own agreements that we provide family violence leave to our own employees, and that sort of condition should be extended to all employees across the country.
Thank you, Councillor Greco. Councillor Lawrence?
Yes, Madam Mayor. As councillors who have been served previously will understand, we do go to the ALGA conference in Canberra, and it is dominated by other states, and it's safe to say it is dominated by conservative voices. So it's very important when people have raised issues both of gender equality and also openness and transparency, we find our motions are often put at the end of the conference and are lost. And so when we're having a progressive change, which we are having in Victoria in terms of state government's actions on domestic violence, it's important that we take this to the peak bodies and talk about it, because the banks are talking about it, the private sector is talking about it, and the whole of Australian local government need to deal with it.
Thank you. Are there any further speakers? I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? It's carried unanimously. Is there any further urgent business? No. Is there any general business?
Just a procedural question, Madam Mayor, through you,
yes,
possibly the Governance Manager. We noted that 8.7 and 8.8 as notice of motions were being incorporated into a
7.1
general business item, but we haven't actually dealt with 8.6, and I'm just wondering, do we have to procedurally deal with it in some manner? Withdraw it or...
Oh,
lapse.
Ms. Stevens, it's lapsed.
We need to deal with it.
It's lapsed.
Yeah, but
was it not incorporated?
It was never brought.
No, it wasn't incorporated.
It's motion 8.6.
The motion sort of was stronger and it replaced 8.6. Is that correct?
Madam Mayor, just the question I ask is
procedurally, do we need to do anything?
I mentioned specifically 8.7, 8.8 to be incorporated, but I didn't deal with 8.6. Because its subject matter had been dealt with, but as an item, does it need to be dealt with? That's what I'm asking.
Could I propose that Councillor Greco, as the mover, could withdraw the motion and note in the minutes that the matter referred to in 8.6 has been dealt with under the Future of Preston Market item already, because it's specifically specifically been referred to in the matter dealt with by Councillor Greco.
Thank you. Councillor Greco?
Veto.
Yeah. Do we? Yeah, that's fine. So 8.6 has been withdrawn. So there is no general business. We'll move on to item 12, which is records of assemblies of councillors.
Happy to move that.
Do I have a seconder? Put that to the vote. All those in favour? It's carried. Reports by mayors and councillors, item 13.
Happy to move that.
Thank you, Councillor. Thanks, Councillor Amir. I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried. So we are moving to item 14, which is consideration of reports considered confidential.
Mayor, just given that if we were to consider that item next, we would be asking members of the gallery to leave the chamber. We are due to receive planning applications at 8 p.m. I'm just wondering, with a little bit of a procedural motion to reorder the agenda slightly, so that we hear 6.1 and 6.2, and if time permits, before 8 p.m. 6.3, just to get those off the agenda.
Sorry,
6.1, 2 and 3.
1, 2 and 3, okay.
Rather than asking members of the gallery to leave the chamber.
Do I have a seconder for the procedural motion?
I'll second.
Thank you, Councillor Amir. I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried. So we'll move now to item 6.1, financial report, 3 months ended 30th of September 2016.
I'm happy to move that.
Thanks, Councillor Greco. Do I have a seconder? Thanks, Councillor Rennie. Councillor Greco.
Yeah, look, this is a 3 monthly report that we receive. It covers the first quarter of the year up to the 30th of September and basically gives a snapshot, if you like, of the council's performance in financial performance and accountability back to the community. The report's pretty straightforward. It's very early in the piece. It's the first 3 months. There are some discrepancies between what's in our budget and what the actual figures are, but those discrepancies have been identified and have been explained, and they're mainly due to timing differences, as one can expect very early on in the piece in the financial year. The only thing that I would note is that is the capital performance. Our capital expenditure was only 6.13 million, which is 7.4 million behind the budget. But I understand in the report that it's mentioned that some invoices or payments have been made or not made,
committed,
been put forward for about $6 million, which actually makes the figures therefore align in relation to what our budgeted figures are, what our actual figures are. So everything's running pretty smoothly in terms of the budget. Again, it's early in the piece. Something we have to constantly monitor, and we'll be reporting back to the community on a quarterly basis in relation to our results.
Thank you, Councillor Greco. Councillor Rennie?
I'm confident, based on information both in the report and through the audit subcommittee that I'm part of, that the financial statement is greater, that we're in a sound position, so.
Thank you. Are there any further speakers? If not, I will put that to the vote. All those in favour? It's carried unanimously. Item 6.2, external communication activity update.
I've got an amendment to that which was sent through to officers and councillors this afternoon. So I'm happy to move that if there's a seconder.
Madam Chair, I'd just like to restate an interest in this item.
Yes.
And my interest in this item relates to one of the negative newspaper reports that's listed here. I'm not sure which page in the officer's report, on page 10, and my interest is that I have commenced legal action on three parties on that. I'm not free to go into it any more than that, and so that is an interest but not a conflict of interest.
Thank you. And so you will remain in the chamber?
Yes, I'll remain in the chamber.
Thank you.
Madam Mayor, I have a question on this item.
Yes.
I'd also like to ask.
Would you like to ask your question now?
Yes, I'm just interested on page 10. There's a reference to an item, Councillor Campaign Flyer to Residents, which I actually believe is a community survey to residents prior to the election period. And I'm just as listed as negative news, and I'm just interested why it hasn't been noted the correction to that that was printed on page 5 recently with the leader. Question to officers.
Mr. Seeger.
I would take that on notice. I don't have any information that may have to confirm otherwise.
Thank you. So the motion is as stands on screen. Is there a second to Councillor McCarthy's motion? Thank you, Councillor Rennie. Councillor McCarthy?
Look, I'll make this very brief. It's an informational report that Council receives, I believe on an annual basis, just an update in relation to communication activity, what Council does within existing communication channels to engage with residents around both questions, issues, events, you name it. It's outlined there in detail. I'll go to the second point just quickly, which is that we're a new council, and obviously it's important that we have a strong handle and an understanding of what communication council is undertaking, what is effective, and how we can best support that. And so hence the need for a briefing regarding our plans for next year. One of the important things, and I think our team here does a great job, but communication is changing all the time, and the needs of our residents in terms of how they want to be engaged with is also changing. And I just draw to Council's attention on page 9, there is the percentages in terms of from two years ago from a survey that Council undertook in terms of how our community said it wanted Council to communicate with them. I would ask whether those figures are the same, whether they've shifted, whether they reflect the whole community. Obviously, there's a real disjoint sometimes in local government between a lot of things being put through social media and people don't see them, and likewise, things being put through the local paper and people don't receive the local paper. So you can't please everyone, but we have a responsibility here in this chamber to make sure that every resident is made aware of every issue that affects them. And that's the guiding principle that sits above all of our communication activity. And so that residents have that opportunity to participate in decisions that affect them, to be able to contribute, to attend events that Council puts on, and of course, critically, when they think something isn't right or they'd like to see something change, that it's easy for them to access either this chamber, their councillor, whoever it might be. So whilst I commend the detail in this report and the information it gives us, our challenge now is to understand how do we do the best job we can communicating with and alongside our residents on every issue that affects them. I'll end it there, and if other councillors wish to add, then that's fine too.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. Councillor Rennie? No, does any other councillor wish to speak? If not, I'll put that...
I just want to note that in this report, and I'm glad what Councillor McCarthy has put there, that the report that will be coming back will be Council's communication plan. But I'd just like to note, and I won't put this as an amendment, that I'm hoping out of that communications a report that does come back, that some attention or deserved attention is given to how we communicate with our cold community, with our multicultural community. Because I know, for example, in relation to the communication outputs, that the report talks about. I just wonder how many of those communication outputs are targeted to ethnic communities. Mm-hmm. And also I note in the report, when it talks about media coverage, I note that there's no coverage in the ethnic press. And so I just wonder whether we're actually doing enough in regards to communicating with our very, very sizable multilingual community in the city of Darabin.
Thank you, Councillor Greco. Any further speakers? Councillor Lawrence.
Just briefly, Madam Mayor. On the issue of ethnic media, and I have had the honour of being Mayor of the city twice and recently, and the ethnic community papers, specifically some of our major languages, Chinese, Greek, Italian, Arabic, are very proactive, come into regular briefings, I found, on a monthly basis and interacted. And it would be interesting to see what our paid advertising is in that area too.
Thank you. Any further speakers? If not, I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried unanimously.
Item 6.3, upcoming landfill regional waste contract.
I'll move that, Mayor, with additional points which were circulated to councillors and staff
this
afternoon.
Can we put that up on screen, though? Thank